So good afternoon.
Yeah.
And thanks, Tech, for your intro. Okay, how do you use this? There you are. Okay, this is my presentation. When I prepared this, I was actually stumped by the topic, rights-based regulation. Of course, we come from the human rights community, but how to link rights-based to taxation, to regulation, is something that I really have to sort out. But there, so that will be my first slide, to connect my presentation to a rights-based approach. So we all know taxation is a form of regulation. It's a way to encourage or discourage different types of behavior. In taxation, you have the concept of sumptuary taxation, which is applied to discourage certain goods and services that society sees as undesirable. Good example would be tobacco, alcohol. And Veronica did cite Thaler, Richard Thaler, and I can cite him in the sense that a regulation can be done in different ways, but Thaler and Sustine have proposed what we can call as the a softer way of control, the nudge, the concept of the nudge, or what he calls paternal liberalism. So from a rights-based perspective, taxation or is a way of nudging. In that context, one respects choice. You don't prohibit. And maybe this can also apply to the issue of drugs. Is prohibition really the best way of regulation? So one has to respect choice. Then you have the through taxation, you go through democratic decision making. There's inclusiveness in the making of a policy. So it's in these areas where the role of civil society plays an important role. For my presentation, my argument here is that the role of civil society is not just to participate or to be included in the whole process. And we always fall into that trap. We attend meetings left and right, they get our inputs, and that's it. What I want to show here is that civil society itself can be very decisive in regulation or in policy formulation. That it's not just about the president or Congress coming out with a good bill and civil society rooting for the champions. But we can argue that in some instances, and I hope it will become more frequent, civil society impact has become a significant determinant, so to speak, in shaping that particular regulation. And in this case, I'll be presenting a case study on tobacco tax. So my presentation is more of a case study, it's not a normative one, just to show how civil society can play that significant role in shaping regulation or policy. Oh, sorry. Okay, so what's the relevance of this study right now? My case study is about the sin tax in 2012. The sin tax refers to the tobacco and alcohol excise taxes, which were passed in 2012 during the previous administration. It has relevance now because at present, government is coming out with a comprehensive tax reform program called Tax Reform for Acceleration and Inclusion. Actually, this reform has been there for a long time, but for some reason, it has not gained momentum. So our case study can be some kind of a template on how the train can move with the participation of a civil society. It can likewise provide insights into other areas of advocacy, not necessarily on economic reforms alone, on other areas as well. For example, there is now a bill on universal health care, on education reform, on pension reform, etc. And finally, it has been established that the Philippine syntax advocacy has become a global best practice, and it has been documented in several papers. Okay. So what is it all about? There's some. Sequencing of my slides, something wrong. Okay, what I forgot to include in my slides is what the piece was all about. It was about, it's all about the lessons. Sorry. I forgot to include some slides, maybe my rush in sending the presentation. What was the problem? The problem then was the tax structure for alcohol and tobacco was bad. It was complicated, too many rates. There was protection for the what we call the legacy brands for tobacco. And for alcohol, local products were likewise protected in a way that violated WTO rules. Tax rates were very low. We had one of the lowest tax rates in the region and in the world. So there was really a need to reform the tobacco and alcohol excise taxes. And every attempt to reform the excise taxes ended in naught. There was an attempt between 1997 and 2012, but everything turned out what the result was a very weak law. But we had an opportunity in the administration of Aquino, a reformist presidency, to push for a good law on tobacco and alcohol. And we did get what we want, the outcomes here. As I said, problem number one, very low rates. We got significantly higher rates. I recall, for example, that before the reform, the tax for the low-price tobacco was 2 pesos and 72 centavos. Now it's 30 pesos. So imagine that, from 272 to 30. Of course, the increase was over time. But now we have significantly higher rates. There's been a correction of the tax structure. We have moved to just one rate, regardless of price, regardless of brand. Before, there were 3 or 4 rates, which was bad for tax administration, which also led to less revenues, which was not good either for health, in the sense that smokers, for example, would just shift to the lower-priced cigarette. But with one tax, we were able to optimize one tax rate, we were able to optimize revenue, we were able to optimize health outcomes. And there is now an automatic adjustment for inflation in perpetuity, 4% every year, starting next year. So it's a good law. Furthermore, the revenue, the incremental revenue from the taxes has been earmarked for universal health care, for health programs. So here are some. Just look at the dramatic increase in excise tax revenues. You just can't see the year, but you can see the spike after 2012 in terms of the revenue, especially for tobacco. The blue curve is tobacco, the red line is alcohol. You can just see how dramatic the increase was for the revenues for the budget of health. As I said, the revenue, the incremental revenue from the taxes was allocated to health. And here you can see an increase, a dramatic increase too, in the budget of the Department of Health. Another health outcome is this. See the red line? There also has been a significant decline in the number of smokers or in the smoking prevalence rate. From 31% before the reform, down to 25.4 after the first year of the reform, and still going down to 23.3 by 2015. So, good examples of the tobacco tax. And here are the main lessons. Well, the first is, or I think I used another slide. Okay. Some of the lessons, having a broad coalition involving government champions, civil society, and that was really broad from economic reforms groups to health groups, former senior government officials, academics, business groups, youth groups, even tobacco farmers. And this was the first time where you had a very broad coalition involving different sectors for a tax reform. A tax reform is not really palatable to many in the sense that, well, who really likes taxes? Before this same tax reform, as I said, there were previous attempts to increase the tax rates for alcohol and tobacco. But the problem was the coalition was very narrow, composed mainly of the likes of Gilbert Yanto, Winnie Monsod. The coalition was made up of academics and economists and technocrats. But here, the advocates learned the lesson after about 10, 12 years of advocacy that the coalition has to be broadened. The broadening of the coalition is tied up to the framing of the advocacy that it is, I'm saying is because we continue with that advocacy now, that it is primarily a health issue, not a revenue enhancement measure. Of course, they go together. In the case of alcohol and tobacco, you consider this as what economists call inelastic products. So even if you increase the rate, the demand will still be there, and hence government can earn the revenues. But by framing the issue as a health issue, in the sense that, as I said, going back to the first slide, tobacco and alcohol are bad, we want to discourage consumption, we get broader support from the population, especially from the health community. So the coalition is no longer about the, it's no longer made up of technocrats and economists. The coalition was indeed broad, precisely because the people and civil society would appeal to the issue of health. So that part of framing is having a clear communication strategy, which is to emphasize the health objective as the driver of that advocacy. There is also a design in terms of the incentive, which Veronica also mentioned a while ago, incentives for the politicians. So we had a very strong resistance from the tobacco lobby, but one way to break that resistance was also to get support of the legislators. And one way to get their support is to earmark the revenues, not only for health, of course that's popular, but even allocating a part of the earmarked revenue for local governments and congressional districts. So these are the other lessons, but what really matters is the need to frame the issue as a health issue and the corresponding building of a broad coalition. Of course, it's also important to mention the role of the leadership, particularly the president. In a presidential system, the president is very powerful. He can use his resources or the government's resources to influence the votes of Congress. Okay. But here, let's talk more about the role of civil society. Okay. As I said, a civil society played a critical role in framing the health issue. When this advocacy began, the Department of Finance was on top of it. Of course, the Department of Finance would not think about health issues. The main concern of the Department of Finance is how to generate more revenues, especially at that time there was a fiscal constraint. So civil society came in together, especially the doctors, and said, let's make this a health issue primarily. You still get the revenues, but let's make this a health issue. Okay. Civil society also push for the maximum objectives, and I will go to another slide here. This one. You have two bills. One's the original bill of the Department of Finance. Where's that? That one. The original bill of the Department of Finance is called for very moderate increases. Actually, they would have been significant considering that the tobacco lobby, the alcohol lobby, but here we're talking about the tobacco issue. The tobacco lobby was very strong. Recall that the tax rate before was only 272 for the low-price brand. So the Department of Finance wanted to increase the rate from 650 going to 14 by year two. But look at the position of civil society. Civil society introduced a different bill leading to a 30 peso increase. 30 to 30 versus 14. Look at that. And what was the outcome? And here's the outcome. Very close to the civil society position of 30. That's 30, right? Yeah, 30. Of course, over a longer period of time, but not that long. So the final version was in fact the civil society version. But we have to give credit to our legislator here. It's Dina Abad. Unfortunately, she passed away a couple of weeks ago. So this is one legacy of Representative Dina Abad. So, Action for Economic Reforms approach Representative Dina Abad to push for this bill, and we got it. So here's a clear case where civil society gave a policy input, and that policy input turned out to be the law. Okay. Sorry, I'm just skipping. I have a time constraint. Don't have to go back to what AER is. AER, my organization, was one of the civil society organizations that was part of the coalition. But here are some of the attributes of civil society organizations. Why we have to have civil society? Civil society, one, is free from the bureaucratic constraints. That's having the flexibility, the mobility to respond to quick changing conditions. So there was collaboration between the government champions then and civil society. Civil society has its own comparative advantages compared to government. In fact, some of the tasks that government cannot do or did or would have a hard time doing, it decided to delegate to civil society. Just to give you an example, we were assigned to talk to or to threaten, a particular congressman, the budget secretary then couldn't threaten a particular congressman. So it was civil society who threatened that congressman to do something about the passage of the law. So there you are. We are assigned to civil society can be assigned such sensitive tasks that government cannot do. Then, of course, that means additional resources for government, human, intellectual, logistical, in pushing for the reform. Then you have the informal network. So civil society has some comparative advantages that will complement the work of government in pushing for a particular law or a particular regulation. So there you are. I guess I can